Hello and welcome back to ID24 2019.
It's coming to you with help from our gold supporters at Intopia and Barclays Access. We're broadcasting live to YouTube with captions. Please head over to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24. Hit that subscribe button just to show us you're out there and enjoy the next few talks. Before that though, a quick reminder that we are also on Twitter at ID24Conf. And if you have questions for any of our speakers over the next hours, just put in the hashtag ID24 and we'll pick them up and ask them at the end of each talk. We are a respectful community at Inclusive Design 24, so we have a code of conduct, which is available on our website. Please do take a look and be friends with everybody out there. And now I think it's probably time to hand over to Ian.
Yes, and now we have Henri Helvetica, who will be speaking on the subject of the tipping point, how performance decisions make accessibility differences. Over to you.
Merci, merci. Hello, 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 world. Welcome to The Tipping Point. Like Ian said, it's a talk on how performance decisions make accessibility differences. And obviously, this is for hashtag ID24, Inclusive Design 24. I want to thank Leonie and Ian and company for having me. Now, that is my Twitter handle at the bottom, by the way. Now, originally, as much as I did call it how performance decisions make accessibility differences, I almost feel like the correct subtitle should be how performance decisions make inclusive design differences. And I'll tell you why a little later. I kind of should have made that edit. Let me turn this up. Now, having said that much, allô, or should I say bonsoir? I'm in Toronto, it's night here. So who am I? My name is Henri, last name is not Helvetica, it's a long story, it's just essentially a Twitter handle gone mad. I'm a freelance developer in Toronto. I do a little bit of speaking, I'm going to do a little bit more writing soon, I hope, and I tend to enjoy conversations around the performance space. And it's a space that I consider great, and at the same time, it's like a Gordian knot, so at times it's a little challenging, but it's a lot of fun. So, we are here to talk about inclusive design. So when I took on this opportunity to speak about this very topic, I thought to myself, like, man, I know I'm not a heavy-duty accessibility engineer, so I was trying to figure out how to tackle this. And I started to dig around, and I dug around some more, and I realized, you know what, this is really an inclusive design conversation. And accessibility happens to be a component of inclusive design. Inclusive design is something that I could take on much more easily. And that was actually confirmed after I read the following. I went dig around for some definitions, and obviously I pulled up the first one I found, which was Wikipedia. And it said, inclusive design is a design process not restricted to interfaces or technologies in which a product, service, or environment is optimized for a specific user with specific needs. And I thought to myself, okay, it's not too bad, but it didn't really say a lot that I wanted to hear. But I did lean on one, a different one, pardon me, that I found as well. Inclusive design is the design of an environment so that it can be accessed and used by as many people as possible, regardless of age, gender, and disability. This is one that I liked. It covered a lot of different areas. Age, obviously, because we do know at age, a lot of things can happen from vision challenges to motor skills and the challenges there. Yes, gender was mentioned. And obviously, disabilities is always going to be a staple when we talk about accessibility and making sure we have inclusive design. Now, is it really just that though? We're gonna revisit this definition a little later. But we are here also to talk about performance too. And really, we're just essentially gonna have a conversation. So sit back and relax. But where does performance fit in all of this? And this really started a little while back when I had a convo a couple of years ago, when at a meetup, I was discussing performance and accessibility with a few people, one of which was David Newton, who's at Shopify now. Marcy Sutton was in the conversation, George Zamfir, et cetera, a few people that we know in the accessibility space. But when we see performance, we do like to talk about speed, and that's without a doubt. But again, when we do talk about accessibility, we start to look at things like, obviously, mobility, because that's always going to be a component of accessibility. We talk about low vision, we talk about blind users, we talk about users who are colorblind as well. That's always, again, going to be a component of accessibility conversations. Cognitive challenges, without a doubt. And obviously, we're going to talk also about hearing impairment. But in our case, we're going to definitely focus in on the fact that accessibility and performance, there is a link. But how do they mix? We know that with accessibility, or pardon me, we know that with performance, we have a user experience story. And this is something that we start to talk about a lot more readily as time went by. Performance was being framed as a user experience issue. How did the site feel? How did the users respond? Was the screen responsive? And obviously, was it loading fast? Then we understood also that accessibility also was a user experience conversation. Were users able to complete a task? How did they feel? Were there any kind of delays? Were the buttons big enough, et cetera, et cetera? Could you navigate easily through the page? And it, again, I'll go on and say, how did users respond? Was it well? Now, being that performance and accessibility both had user experience issues, and if we sit back and do the math, we can surmise that accessibility and performance certainly do have a link. We can, in fact, frame them as distant relatives if you want. But we are here to dig in a bit more about performance. And the one thing that we can't deny when it comes to performance and when it comes to user experience as well is that everyone will suffer when things are slow. And we call that ultimately latency. Now, latency in computer layman's terms, the delay before a transfer of data, or also a time delay between the cause and effect. We are now experimenting with protocols like H3, QUIC, that will provide zero RTT, which is what we call round trip times. So latency is very important. And if you think about it, it's taken this long to try to solve one of the biggest issues. Latency is absolutely an anti-pattern. And you know, if you really think about it, and for the people out there who are familiar with screen readers and screen reader users, and I've been able to see this myself firsthand, as I'm sure you guys have as well, how they operate as quickly as possible. It's actually something to behold. But the one thing we can't deny, they do it and they do it very fast. So obviously, speed is going to be fairly important, or at least reducing latency. Now, when we talk about latency, we are talking about trying to not have slow experiences. We know that slow experiences are bad user experience. So ultimately, something that is poor in inclusive design will also affect accessibility. So what I would like to explore in the next little while is how latency anti-patterns are contributing to the slow experiences and obviously to the slow user experience by default. So when it comes to performance decisions, the goal was, is, and always will be delightful user experiences. This is something that Steve Satter said some time back. Steve Satter is, by the way, a speed curve, a performance monitoring company. The only thing after, the only thing we're after are good user experiences. That's the bottom line. When the user experience or the UX works well, users are simply happy. Just like the image of this woman here seen smiling. I mean, the alt tag is actually a picture of a woman smiling ear to ear because she just found out I'm single, but we could talk about that another time. But what we will talk about right now are some of these very challenges that we have to deal with. Now, on the way to the creating these great user experience moments, we have faced major hurdles. There were some tough lessons along the way, and some came to us at later moments in time. Now, the web as we know it right now is about 30 years old, plus or minus a year, just over 30 actually. It was pretty much a text-based medium, not too much interactivity or images in fact. But what we had back then isn't what we have now, and especially not at current day. Because current day, you know, we certainly started on desktops, powerful desktops at that, large screens, retina screens, essentially. But unfortunately, what we have then is not really what we have today. Today, the landscape is absolutely different, and it looks something like this. Mobile. We are basically in a mobile world. And I like to believe this is nothing that was in fact foreseen coming. The ability to take desktop functionality, in some cases power, and make it as portable as a pocket device. In performance, this is a big part, if not a large part, or even predominantly one of our part of our conversations. If you want to talk about your challenges around performance decisions, they are rooted in mobile. Why? Well, let's talk about why. Here's some very interesting stats, and you know, they're well documented. In 2016, mobile usage eclipsed the desktop use, and this is on a worldwide level. And if you think about that, that is essentially never going to change. It's like, you know, being past the date, you'll never be able to go back and revisit this date. This is very important because new markets are getting on the web via mobile only. And that's for a number of reasons, but one of them is price point and access. They're able to jump on the web now for the cost of maybe $40, $50, maybe $100. This also is a reality, and this is a picture that I like to use to illustrate a very salient point. Now, this is a photo of a woman, likely in an emerging market, but she's clearly on the phone. And I think this is so key in framing the bigger part of the conversation. These are markets that are essentially mobile only. And specifically, they're on mid to low end devices, which is the spectrum that we like to discuss heavily. In fact, the growth in users or the user base that's growing the quickest is in these very territories. I like to call them, I like to draw a comparison between G7 countries and the rest of the world, but the G7 countries, as we know them right now, have more or less a flat growth. So essentially we are building the web for some of these emerging markets. In fact, out of all the people in the world that have various disabilities, 80% live in the global south/emerging markets. And this is a quote by a UX researcher at Google by the name of, and I don't wanna, you know, screw the name up too much, Nithya S, I'll say. But these are very important data points because once again, if you're talking about, whether you're talking about accessibility or inclusive design, you're likely going to have to deal with some of these emerging markets or markets in general, and ultimately having to deal with serving that population. Now, dealing with this market and the fact that we are on mobile predominantly, we have to also understand what the network conditions or the operating conditions are like for these mobile phones. And as you can see right here, network-wise, 4G is 29% of the global network connection. 3G is 31%, but 2G is 40% of worldwide global connections. So once again, we are talking about having to deal with some very tough conditions on mobile and having to make sure that we create some very, some good inclusive designs. Some have brought up the idea that 5G is coming and it's on its way, but there are so many limitations to oversee before this can be legitimately considered. I wouldn't really bring that into conversation. Now, again, mobile has exploded because of cheap price points. But with that being said, we also have to deal with small screens. We also have to deal with things like low memory. We also have to deal with the fact that a lot of these communities that are on these devices are do recognize that that data is at a premium. So a lot of the resources that we have to deal with, we have to make sure that we manage properly. And we're gonna talk about that as well. But these very items are part of this mobile explosion. Another thing that I'd like to sort of like slide in there is, you know, although we've talked about the fact that mobile and low-end users are predominantly in some of these emerging markets are lower tier. We have India as number one. We have number three users of low-end devices being Russia. But a bit of a shocker is that the number two market for low-end devices is the USA. So what does that mean? Essentially, it's telling us that we have to make sure, even within our own G7 shores on our side of the world, that we make sure these experiences are as are well-designed as possible. And another challenge is the following. A lot of these phones that we see and we feel that eventually the users may upgrade, they may move to like an iPhone 7 or iPhone 8 or whatnot. One of the challenges is that these phones don't ever leave the grid. They actually get passed down to family members, to friends, to other users in general. So the idea that eventually we'll be able to, you know, get past the fact that some of these devices are low powered is actually not the case. So yes, we've talked about mobile for a minute. We need to design for slow and intermittent networks. The complete lack of connectivity also needs to be taken in consideration. Like I mentioned, people are slower to adopt to newer technologies. So we have to make sure that we are, oh, wrong page. Sorry about that. So I mentioned earlier that we have to be able to manage the resources properly. And when it comes to performance, it's all about resources, always. Obviously with the hardware as well. So let's look at some of these said resources and what exactly is happening. Now, oddly enough, images are a problem for performance, certainly, and also accessibility. So on the performance side, they are always going to be the largest resource online to send down the wire. Now, I'll share some of these stats in the slides, but the median desktop and median mobile amount of images is virtually the same. And on a per request level, it's almost identical. Now, as much as it's the largest resource for online, it's actually also a number two issue in accessibility. Now, according to that AIM study on a million sites that and about WCAG failures that I'm sure quite a few of you have read, and if for those who haven't, I'll supply the link as well. The number two issue was around images and specifically around alternative text. Now, put that together, obviously on the image and performance side, that is an actual anti-pattern. The large images take quite a bit of time to come down the pipe. And if you're sending down the exact same amount of data to the desktop, and mobile at the same time, again, that is an anti-pattern. Why? Well, these things create decoding issues when large amounts go down to mobile. They're actually also a source of apps crashing due to memory challenges. And that's especially on mid to low model phones. And pardon me, add that to the fact that, again, in markets from the emerging markets to even the G7 shores, people are getting more and more sensitive to data costs. And massive images, they eat up data. Users are forced to make decisions around potentially, cutting off the internet temporarily and things like that. So these are challenges that we need to take in order to have some proper inclusive design. Now, luckily, with some of this newer technology, we have some APIs that are here to essentially save the day. And some of these APIs, I'm just gonna rifle through. Now, an example that I'd like to bring up is the fact that over the years, YouTube has made some significant retooling to address performance issue. And again, performance issues, pardon me. And again, we're talking about from speed to also data consumption. Some of you may remember the famous YouTube Feather project. I'll provide a link to that as well. YouTube Go was actually another project based around the performance on mobile. It was an opportunity to look at video and the data costs associated with streaming and or downloading that video. But the most important part is that YouTube employs adaptive bit rates so that it can adjust the bit rate depending on the user's network, whether it be a good or bad connection. Now, in modern speak, we have things on the browser side like the NetInfo API. And this is something that I'd like to talk about, or should I say Network Information API, sorry about the abbreviation. This is something that I like to talk about because it almost mirrors what YouTube was doing, YouTube Go specifically. You can actually pull the network that you're on, or pull, pardon me, the network that you're on and figure out what kind of network it is. Is it a proper connection? Is it slow? What are the round trip times like? And by collecting this information, we're able to make some more research decisions with respect to the kind of resources that you're going to send down the pipe, and especially around images because they are a leading cost of data. So you might be on a train going from a large metro to a small town. You might be at a festival, which are known to sort of clog up the networks and have slow responses. You might be simply traveling where networks aren't the best. And in fact, when I travel quite often enough, make sure I download a map, Google Maps locally, so I have offline use. There are so many uses that you that you can make use of the network information API, but again, it is there specifically to deal with some of these challenges around providing a good user experience. Now, something that used to be, at least I'll talk about it, that used to be a feature that Chrome was playing with at the time, which is called heavy page capping. Now, this was specifically going to be set up so that when resources coming down the wire on mobile hit a certain amount, they were projecting or they were playing with the idea of capping the amount of data. Now, it was getting a little complicated. It was behind a flag, obviously, but the biggest fact is that this was being considered, again, in order to provide a good user experience amongst some of the other challenges that are met with downloading many resources. This was being considered. It may come back, we're not too sure, but as of right now, it's been pulled from the browser. One solution would be something like this. How about having less images? And this is something that was discussed a few times when some companies would go back and do performance audits on their products online and find out that, you know what, they had an excess in images. Maybe they had some, you know, some extra marketing images that they could pull, or they may have had some, I don't know, some items that were no longer available, considering if they were retail sites or something of the sort. But these are decisions that are being made in order to make sure that leaner sites, and considering that there was such a shift to mobile, that they had to make sure that they were being responsible with the data that were sending down the wire. So this is something that is also being considered in order to provide a better user experience. Now, another API that I felt was very important in the conversation, which was the paint timing API. And again, we're talking about providing a proper user experience here. And as an API, the paint timing is another, which will allow us to get a sense of what was arriving to the user's screen and how quickly. Now, specifically, I want to highlight the paint, first contentful paint. Now, by definition, the first contentful paint reports the time when the browser first rendered any text, image, including background images, non-white canvas, or SVG. This excludes any content of iframes, but includes text with pending wet farms. This is the first time users could start consuming page content. I'll say it again. This is the first time users could start consuming page content. Now, this FCP, as we like to call it, abbreviated, pardon me, this is important because this is essentially the first time we can actually measure when a user can say specifically, oh, I see a font coming in, oh, I see an image coming in, I'm beginning to interact with the page, this is the perfect time. Now, once we start to make these measurements, you can start to see when it is that the user was getting this information. Was it taking too long? Well, if it was, you can go back and try to figure out what was the blocking resource potentially that was keeping this from being executed. Now, another fairly important API that we like to talk about is time to interactive. Now, at times, you know, there's been some debate as it may not be the best at providing a very precise measurement, but we can get an overall view of what's going on. Now, the time to interactive, or TTI as we know it, is a metric which measures how long it takes a page to become interactive, plain and simple. Now, when we talk about interactivity, this is pretty much talking about JavaScript. Now, this is where, as part of the SCP, if we have, say, a button that needs to be interactive, is it usable? What is happening when the user is tapping on this button? Is some kind of action taking place? Is it not? And again, getting back to the definition, the page has displayed some useful content, which is measured by the FCP, first contentful pane. The event handlers are registered for most visible page elements, and the page is responding to user interactions within 50 milliseconds. Now, anything above 50 milliseconds is where we start to have some mild concerns. Anything largely beyond that, that's where you definitely want to go back and see what it is that is happening with the interactivity of the page. And again, imagine a user trying to hit the buy button, but nothing's working. That is a performance challenge. And that's what we like to look at as well. Part of the solutions with this, we know that we can do some tree shaking with the payloads. We know we can reduce also the payloads with some code splitting. There are some great apps out there that are there to kind of help us out with this process. And that's important because, again, if we start to think about these mid to low end devices, they are not essentially built to handle a lot of this JavaScript coming down the pipe. And again, I'm going to provide some links for some further readings on some of these topics. Now, I did just mention, code splitting. Obviously, that's very important. And that is something that has come along the way in order to help us manage the amount of JavaScript that's being sent down the pipe. The one thing I'd like to highlight as well is something that we call code coverage. Now, what is code coverage? Well, it's essentially a way to look at the amount of code that is going unused in a particular app. Why is this important? Well, if you remember, code coverage will show you the amount of resources that went down the pipe unused. And the challenge there is the following. Whether it be used or unused, it is still being parsed. And parsing CSS, parsing JavaScript, and obviously decoding images is very important and also fairly taxing. So is there a way that we can minimize the amount of code going down the pipe if we know that we're not going to use it? Yes, there is. Now, I like to reference this one quote by, I'm going to say Marco Zihi, who's actually going to be a speaker a little later during this event. I'm sorry if I mispronounce your last name, but I was put on to him by Eric Bailey, actually, who's going to speak later on today as well. But I love this quote that he had. A lot of data needs to be fetched across a process boundary. But I really love this part especially. So the amount of data that needs to be fetched actually matters a lot now. I'll repeat that. So the amount of data that needs to be fetched actually matters a lot now. So if we're fetching more data than we need, that is a challenge and potentially an anti-pattern. Continuing the quote, reducing that by filtering out objects we don't need is a good way to reduce the time it takes for information to reach assistive technology. So once again, we're being told that by having an excess of resources coming down the pipe, this is going to hinder the ability for AT or assistive technology to start their job. This is something that we think about as well, and this is something that you should consider. I'm going to make a mention of font loading because since we're talking about SRs, screen readers, and reading content, it'd be tough to talk about this without mentioning fonts. Zach Leatherman has written what I would consider a small encyclopedia, a standard on font loading. It's pretty much some exhaustive work, and you can definitely check out what he's done. But once again, once you realize that font loading is at the mercy of the network, you have to start to make decisions around how you bring them in, because you want them to be painted to the screen as quickly as possible with the shortest delays in order to make users happy as well. And you can get them interacting with the page as fast as possible. Now, much of the solutions involve some very careful selection of resource ins, some very tailored CSS, and obviously some browser support as well, which we're going to talk about in a hot minute. But this is something that you also want to consider, because I'll say it again, the font is a resource, and it has to come down the wire, which means you're going to get some fetching, which means you're going to get some round trip times involved. And these are delays, or what we like to call latency. Now, something that I came across while doing a little bit of research around some fonts. Obviously, you know, in dealing with fonts, we're dealing also with font weights. So how many font weights will you be loading? Will you have just the one, or will you have a few and bringing in some, say, to highlight a short phrase? Well, through some research, a woman by the name of Melissa Barnhart, who's a UX researcher, found out that italics made reading more difficult. It was a little surprise to me, but now that I know that, I might start to make more informed decisions about the fonts that I bring in. Now, am I going to bring in an italic font just to have an italic weight just to have maybe a short sentence highlighted? I don't know. This is something that you'll have to consider as well. And once again, by bringing in an additional weight or style, you are going to have, in all likelihood, another request to consider on the network. I'll mention also the browser support, and I'll say for the following reason. More recently, we've seen that when it comes to mobile, people have been a little slower to upgrade. This is something that's being discussed as we speak right now. And with that being said, you're quite often also getting slower OS updates, because part of updating the OS means a lot of data. Some people are a lot more sensitive to data than others, and they might stick around with something that simply works. So you end up with a bit of a fragmented landscape. So what does that mean? You want to make sure you go with a very simple and inclusive design. You may not want to be at the edge with some of these experimental features. Something that you might want to consider to provide, or to ensure that you provide, a proper user experience. You might recall this old picture of the Android landscape, you know, years ago, used to float around. I've used it in talks in the past. It almost seems like this has not gone away. So it's something that you certainly want to keep in mind. Now, as much as I've talked about performance and the implications, I never really defined it. But this is a definition that I liked a lot from Paul Irish, who works on the Chrome DevTools team, probably lead. Performance is the art of avoiding work. And essentially, avoiding work is what we're trying to do for us as developers, and we're trying to avoid the users. We're trying to avoid them having to do too much work as well. Again, the idea of inclusive design is pleasant UX, and doing more work than we need to is not what we're trying to do. This is a quote that I absolutely loved. When something doesn't work well for users with no disabilities, that pain point is amplified for people with disabilities. And that was from a researcher at Google, Andrew Wong. I thought that was a perfect quote to essentially remind us again is that our poor user experiences as non-disabled users are very much amplified for the people who do have certain disabilities. And once you keep that in mind, you start to make, again, better decisions with respect to your inclusive designs. Now, as a friendly accessibility engineer once said, when your user experience or UX only considers some users, it actually sucks. And that's our good friend, Billy Gregory. Now, in closing, and I know there's going to be quite a few more hours to go, but I'd like to highlight some talks that I believe may be covering some in more depth some of the topics that I covered. I believe Anusha is going to talk about scrolling, something that I think is going to be super important. I'm going to mispronounce this. Eleni is also going to talk about type. Eric Bailey has a fantastic talk on performance coming up. And one that I definitely want to chime in on is the emerging market talk from Claudio and Iona, I believe is the name. And again, apologies if I mispronounced that. But with that being said, I want to thank everyone for listening. I'm definitely going to be sharing my slides with some additional links just so that you can kind of dig in with a bit more depth on some of the items that I covered. And with that being said, I'll be open to take some questions, and apologies for going slightly over.
No problem. And thank you very much, Henri. That was a really terrific talk. I particularly love the fact that you picked on part of inclusion that I think is really important. And that's the idea that it goes beyond disability. Obviously you covered disability too, but you made several sort of remarks around people using low-end devices, people in emerging markets, and how performance can impact their ability to, you know, to be included, to take part. Which kind of leads me to sort of question, what got you interested in the intersection between inclusion, inclusive design, accessibility, and performance?
Oh man, you know, I actually found just even performance in general, I thought what was very fascinating. But once you start to experience what it's like to not have connectivity, to not to be able to, you know, perform some very rudimentary tasks, these things kind of stick with you. And again, it's hard to explain for some who have never sort of experienced it. But if you start to go to some of these, you know, if you speak to people who have some of these challenges on the daily, you'll see at what length they go to make sure that they don't burn data. They'll only hit particular websites at certain times of the day or when they know they have proper bandwidth. And once you start to throw that into your sort of like daily routine, and these are things that some people say in greater metropolitan cities don't experience, you start to have a greater appreciation for that kind of challenge. And I mean, I think this is something that I've always kept in mind. You know, I'm not trying to kind of date myself, but I remember when Image Ready was around with Adobe Photoshop. I was sending smaller versions of these photos to friends of mine, but compressed. So I always had this idea that I didn't want to burn data from my end and also my recipient's end.
Yep, no, that makes complete sense.
So I'm just interested, do you have any thoughts on how much we should care about the processing power and memory of lower end devices compared to just thinking about page weights? Where's the balance there?
I mean, there is a bit of a connection because in all likelihood, page weight will mean that you have an excess of images and potentially large ones. Now, and I'll have a link to the actual quote and potentially talk for those who want to watch it. But the large images that are being sent down the pipe they have to be decoded. And once you start to get into that process, that's when you see the smaller, the lower end devices, they're doing all this heavy lifting and they actually just can't. And between the CPU power and the fact that they likely have low memory, that's when you start to see some of these crashes take place. So there is a bit of a correlation between the two. And I'm not saying that people need to go out and buy, you know, sort of like mortgage their lives to get an iPhone 11 Max Pro, whatever these things are called now. These are experiences that, again, some of these users in these territories and or owners of devices will have from time to time when they get onto these sites that just are fairly carefree about some of the data that they send down the pipe.
That's great. So, looking at like social networks in particular, it seems like animated GIFs are almost as common as videos on the web these days. And mm-hmm. there are some accessibility issues to do with the ability or lack of ability to stop them moving and providing accessible alternatives. But could you talk briefly about any performance issues that we should be aware of?
So around the video side?
Around sort of animated GIFs as a replacement for video.
I mean, so what some people probably know, but many still do not, that the actual GIF format as a video is quite often not a GIF. Even some of these, you know, quote unquote GIF farms that, you know, when you go out and find the best GIF for your tweet or you want to send it to a friend, they're actually not sending GIF, they're actually sending you MP4s.
Right, yeah.
And that's not to say that it's not a large file or anything like that. But, you know, you already have this reduction in size of the format simply because that you've gone with a more optimized, a more modern codec. And as such, you're going to get a much smaller size. Now, with respect to accessibility concerns, obviously, you know, you have the fact that you can't really sort of like label it properly. So you have to sort of like throw out that little alt on Twitter or wherever else you're going to do, post that for affected users. But on a kind of size level, we've probably managed them as best as possible. I mean, there is some conversation around some newer formats that are coming down the pipe. And, you know, maybe they will have a better handle on accessibility. But as we speak right now, that's pretty much how it stands.
Excellent. Okay, thank you very much for that. As Larry says, that was a really fantastic talk. We are at the end of our time. So as with any of our talks, if you like this session, hit the YouTube like button. And don't forget, you can subscribe to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 for future notifications. A reminder that Inclusive Design 24 is brought to you with thanks to our Gold supporters, Barclays Access and Intopia, our Silver supporters, Adobe and Siteimprove, and our Bronze supporters, Samsung Internet, DQ Systems, and the Passiella Group. Inclusive Design will be back on the hour with Andrew Arch and Sarah Pulis, and they will be talking about usability testing with people with disabilities. Thank you very much.